morning. We're so glad that you're joining us today. We're just going to invite the presence of the Holy Spirit to come and join us, join you right where you are, wherever you're watching this live stream this morning. Just feel a special sense that he just wants to come, wants to minister to you today, like he always does when we come with hungry hearts. So just close your eyes and let's just pray together before we begin to sing. Just invite him. Lord, come, we invite you. Come pour into your church. Fall on us afresh. Burn like a fire in our hearts, Lord. We tell you we love you. You are welcome here. Lord, set your church on fire. That's our prayer today. Amen. This song may be new to you. It's really easy. It's called Come Holy Spirit. And it's just a beautiful cry of the church to just have the Holy Spirit come and move. A prayer of surrender. It's just a really beautiful song. It goes like this.
Church on fire.
Surrender to him. Lord, you are my king. You are my king. You are my everything. Lord, let us be more and more aware of your presence all around us, all that you're doing. Let us not become complacent or lukewarm. Let us just burn for you, Lord. Let us just have eyes to see you moving all around.
Speak.
on your heart right now. Come here, right here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere of myself. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Yes, Lord. Oh, we love your presence. King Jesus. Renee, would you just pray for us as we close this time of worship, please?
Lord, we come before you today in gratitude. Not only for your salvation, but that you sent your Holy Spirit to help us this side of heaven. We thank you that you turn our trials into triumphs. That you give us your shield of victory. Your help makes us great. That every good and perfect gift comes from you. And there is nothing we want more than to be in your presence. We thank you, Lord, for all your good gifts. Your mercy and grace, and especially the gift of your Son Jesus, in whose name I pray.
Yes. Amen and amen. Fill up your coffee, stretch your legs for a second. You got 1 minute, and then we'll meet you right back here to dig into his word together. Thanks for worshiping with us.
Oh, guys, hi. Good to see you. Wasn't worship so good this morning? Oh, I love that song, Holy Spirit, by Martin Smith. And do you guys even know Martin Smith, like the lead singer, frontman for Delirious, that like Super Jesus band from, when were they, like the 90s? Oh, man, I don't even know. Like, do you even know who Delirious is? They had such a huge impact on my life as I wasn't starting my Christian walk, but that was kind of the season of my life when I went from being a Christian to being a disciple. That band was so instrumental. And I just have this, I don't know, I have this thought, this little romantic notion that Delirious is going to be the wedding singers at the wedding supper of the Lamb. You know, when all this is over, we're seated down, all the Christians throughout history, we've done it. This is our celebration banquet. Jesus is serving us. This is the wedding supper of the Lamb. And what band is playing in the background? I don't know. I kind of think, and I kind of want it to be Delirious. I don't know. What band would you see playing as the wedding band at the wedding supper of the Lamb? I'd love to hear from you. I think it's Delirious. And that song by Martin Smith, Come Holy Spirit. Oh, or I think it's just called Holy Spirit. Oh, it's so good. One of my favorite lines from that song is, set your church on fire again. Just keep that in the back of your mind as we go through today's message, because we're gonna see that phrase in some form or another pop up again with what we're going to talk about. I'm really excited for what we're going to talk about today and for just the next couple of weeks. We're going to camp out on one theme or one topic for the next couple of weeks. And as we even get, before we even get into the subject matter, the material today, I want to tell you the manner in which I feel like the Lord wants me to deliver these series of messages, okay? So pay attention really close for the next few moments. Well, pay attention the whole time that we're together, but listen closely to how I believe the Lord wants to frame these next couple of weeks, all right? So if you're married, perhaps you've gotten yourself into this situation before, where there's an issue that needs to be talked about, or a conflict that needs to be solved, or a problem that needs to be tackled. And there is this tendency in marriage where one spouse will come at another spouse. And I know it's never happened in your marriage. And if you're not married yet, I'm sure it's never going to happen in your marriage. But the tendency, the rut to fall into is, there is a situation, let's say it's parenting or maybe finances, and the situation gets put in the middle of the table, and one spouse sits across the table, metaphorically speaking, from the other spouse, like, what are you going to do and how are you going to fix this? And even though you might use the language, what are we going to do? It's adversarial because you're sitting across the table from your counterpart, from your spouse. And it's really hard to make meaningful, lasting progress when it feels as though your spouse is coming at you with something. And I know, now don't poke your spouse right now, but what if you were to take a different approach? And instead of sitting across from your spouse in an adversarial way, what if you came around and sat on the same side of the table as your spouse, and that thing, whatever it is, money, kids, in-laws, where you're going to go on vacation, like next Christmas, like whatever it is, instead of putting that in the middle, and then there's this adversarial stance that's taken. What if you came around, sat on the same side of the table as your spouse and said, babe, what are you and I going to do about this problem, making the problem the bad guy? Have you ever thought of that approach? Well, that's in a similar manner. That's the approach that I feel like the Lord has put on my heart to take with the subject matter that we're going to dive into for a few weeks. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to look at the three dangers of the church in Laodicea. The three dangers of the church in Laodicea. And we're going to talk about these three things for the next couple of weeks. But I don't want you to come from the mindset that Jesus is sitting on one side of the table and the church in Laodicea, or us, the church here in Jackson Hole tribe, that he's sitting across the table from us saying, watch out for these dangers, you're in trouble, warning, you better figure this out. Instead, here's how I want you to frame these next couple of weeks mentally, and what I'm going to try to convey. Jesus comes around to our side of the table at tribe and says, hey guys, there are three dangers that awaits any church. I used in history the church of Laodicea, but there are three dangers that any church can fall into. And I want to come along the same side of the table with you and point out these three dangers so that well in advance you can spot them and be aware and avoid them. That's the attitude that Jesus has for us. And that's what I want to try to convey as we go into examining these three different dangers that the church of Laodicea found themselves in. Does that make sense? All right, PB, what are those three dangers? You can write them down, but we're only going to spend time on one of them, all right? We're going to look at how Jesus points out these three different dangers: the danger of indifference, the danger of independence, and the danger of ignorance. And these are all found in the book of Revelation chapter 3. So why don't we read these couple of verses together? Revelation chapter 3, verse 14 through 22. And in your discipleship campus, if you want to press pause on this live stream so that you can read it there with your family or those that are gathered at your campus, you can do that. But I'm going to go ahead and read Revelation chapter 3, verse 14 through 22. Write this letter to the angel in the church in Laodicea. This is the message from the one who is the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of God's new creation. And here's what was told to write. Here's what the angel was told to write. I know all of the things that you do, that you are neither hot nor cold. I wish that you were one or the other. But since you are like lukewarm water, neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. You say, I'm rich. I have everything I want. I don't need a thing. But you don't realize that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. It's really easy with that indictment to see Jesus sitting on one side of the table, really hammering the church in Laodicea. That's not how I want you to view us. Jesus is on the same side of the table as us, saying, hey, look at these three things. Verse 18, I advise you, buy gold from me, gold that has been refined by fire. Then you will be rich. Also buy white garments from me so that you will not be ashamed by your nakedness, and ointment for your eyes so that you will be able to see. Oh, let's keep reading a little bit further. It's so good. I correct and discipline everyone I love, so be diligent and turn from your indifference. Oh, it's so good. Let's keep going. Look, I stand at the door and knock. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and we'll share a meal together as friends. Those who are victorious will sit with me on the throne, just as I was victorious and sat with my Father on his throne. Okay, keep going, keep going. Anyone with ears to hear must listen to the Spirit and understand what he's saying to the churches. What a powerful message from Jesus to the church in Laodicea. Are you familiar with the church in Laodicea? Do you know like where that is and what's going on? Well, let's get on Miss Frizzle's school bus really quick and let's take a tour through history and let's fly to the church in Laodicea during the day and age in which John had this revelation for one of the five churches, one of them being Laodicea. Let's go back in history and look at it really quickly. If you don't know where the church in Laodicea is, we'll just put up this map really quick. Here's a Google image map with the red pin dropped right on the ancient city of Laodicea. It's near the modern day Sia of, oh, I'm going to mess this up. Please, all my friends who speak Turkish, forgive me for how I'm about to butcher this name. Eskihisar. Whew, that was rough. But that's where the ruins of that city lie, is in this modern day city in Turkey. The city of Laodicea was situated right on a main artery of a trade route to Asia Minor. In fact, it was one of the most wealthy cities in all of Asia Minor. It was a very wealthy city. In fact, Laodicea minted their own coins, so they had a huge banking industry. A lot of banks were in that city. There were a high percentage of the population were wealthy. They were very affluent because of the trade route and the banking industry that was there. And they had a very thriving commerce of dark wool that was manufactured in the city of Laodicea. Because they were such a wealthy city, there was a huge emphasis on health. people wanted to stay healthy so that they could enjoy all the money that they were making and buying and selling and trading. And so there was a medical school as well there. This is found through archaeology and historical records. And because of the health and the wealth at that city, there was also a lot of poverty. A lot of people were begging, a lot of people on the streets that were homeless looking for a little handout. And that's the context of the city in which Jesus speaks a message to the angel over the church at Laodicea that the apostle John records. And that's where we see these words of Jesus show up in the book of Revelation. Today, we're going to talk about just one of those three dangers that Jesus identifies. So if you're taking notes, you can write the title of this morning's message at the top of your notes: The Danger of Indifference. That's what we're going to talk about today. The danger of indifference. So all of those verses that we read, verse 14 through 22, let's just zoom in on verse 14 through 16. Three verses, 14, 15, and 16. That's as far as we're going to go today. Why don't we just jump right in to verse 14? I'll read this to you out loud, and you can look it up in your Bible. Verse 14, write this letter to the angel of the church at Laodicea. This is the message from the one who is the Amen. That's Jesus. Jesus is the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of God's new creation. So what we're about to hear, as Jesus gives us this danger, he is not a church consultant. He's not a church planting expert that's got a podcast and a catchy business card. When Jesus says this, before he says this, he's establishing the credibility with which he is about to say and warn the church in Laodicea of these dangers. So he gives a little bit of his credentials. It's not like he's like, hey, I've been doing this for a little while and I've got a flashy website. No. This is the Amen. What he says is Amen. He is faithful, which means he can always be trusted in what he's about to say. He is faithful and true. So what he says is not his opinion. It is truth. And it says that he is the one at the beginning. He's the one that was at the beginning, not just the beginning of the church in Laodicea, but the beginning of the creation of the world. Now that's quite a business resume, if you will. Those are quite the list of credentials, so that when Jesus says, hey, here are some dangers that are about to befall you, we need to listen and pay attention. Well, what is that danger? We're about to get into it. Let's go to the next verse, verse 15. Jesus says, I know all of the things you do. Oh my goodness. Did you know that it is by grace and by faith that we are saved, but it is by the works that we produce that we will be judged? Wait, what did you just say? Ooh, I'm going to leave it there. We can't unpack that. That's a whole nother sermon or even a sermon series. It is by grace that we are saved, but it is by our works that we will be evaluated. Jesus says this, I know all of the things that you do. Then he goes on to give a summation, that you are neither hot nor cold, for I wish that you were one or the other. Now, when we read this, we have to use our imagination to connect the dots. Jesus says, I know all of the things that you do, but then why does he say, I wish you were, but that you're neither hot nor cold? Well, this next sentence would strike at the heart of the people in Laodicea, because they knew where they lived and the geography surrounding them. So if you're a part of our tribe fam and you live here in Jackson Hole, you know that we live near a very geothermal region, where this whole region, the greater Yellowstone Basin, has lots of geyser and thermal activity, right? So you can go down south here to Hoback, and you can go to Astoria Hot Springs, and some of our tribe fam have even been baptized there. You can go up north to Polecat or Huckleberry Hot Springs. Obviously, just a short drive down the road is Yellowstone National Park. Very seismic region with lots of thermal activity. Well, did you know that the city of Laodicea was near a region that had a lot of geothermal activity? Outside of the city of Philadelphia, which is one of the cities that Jesus mentions here in this five churches in the book of Revelation, right outside the city of Philadelphia, there was a famous seismic region, thermal region, that had lots and lots of hot springs and hot pools and mineral baths, and they were used for therapeutic purposes back in these ancient days. But the runoff flowed right through Laodicea as it cooled off, and then eventually cooled off and dumped into the ocean. So the water that ran through, one of the water features that ran through Laodicea, it had all these minerals, but it wasn't cold, but it wasn't hot. It was lukewarm. Now, I don't know about you, if you would ever pay money to sit in lukewarm water. Not me. I would pay money to sit in hot water, and I would pay money to go splash around in cold water. But who wants to pay money to like sit or splash around or bathe around in lukewarm water? And so the people of Laodicea, whenever they read this verse, they instantly had a literal, tangible connection. Lukewarm water is not desirable really for anything. Let's keep reading. Verse 16. But since you are like lukewarm water, what is like lukewarm water? Their faith, the expression of their vitality, the church. Neither hot nor cold, I will, here's the danger ahead. I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. Well, what is it that made the church in Laodicea lukewarm? And in parentheses, let's ask this question of ourselves. What is it that would make the church in Jackson Hole tribe, or let's zoom in even a little more to our own individual lives, what is the danger of us being lukewarm? Well, to get the answer to that question, it helps for you to do a little bit of digging on your own. Look at the letters to the other churches mentioned at the beginning of Revelation. And you will notice this. The church of Laodicea, there is no mention of persecution. There's no mention of difficulty. There's no mention of opposition. There's no mention of hardships. Well, what does that mean? The church in Laodicea wasn't going through a difficult time. They weren't doing anything that really got them on the radar of the enemy. They were just keeping things copacetic. They weren't being a threat to the powers of darkness. The only reason that you come under persecution is when you're about to make some advancement, in the midst of advancement. Church in Laodicea, there's no mention of persecution. But yet, at the same time, there's also no mention of victory. There's no mention of advancement. These guys, just like the expression is, were lukewarm. The church in Laodicea had no great opposition, but they also had no great victories. Well, what does that have to say for us today? Have you ever met somebody that they were warm enough that they could fit in the Christian crowd? Maybe they went to church, they had a Bible, they're part of the Bible studies. They could talk the talk just fine. So they were warm enough to fit in the church, but when they're around different kinds of people, when they're around their friends that don't go to church, that aren't running hard after God, that they easily fit back in with those people as well. They're cold enough that their friends that are cold aren't bothered by their little bit of warmness. Does that make sense at all? Is that hitting home at all? So a person would say, yeah, I mean, but I am running hard after God. Brian, I'm not sleeping around. I'm not smoking weed. I'm not stealing from my job. Like that's what cold people do. I'm not doing any of those things. So I'm not cold. But let's just take a look at the usage on your phone, perhaps. Where are you spending time on your phone? This past week, I've set aside social media and news, and these first couple of days, it's been so hard because I'm realizing whenever throughout the day, if I just need to take a quick little brain break or maybe I need to escape for just a moment, I just pick up my phone and I just go to my different little escapes on my phone, social media, news, and I don't know if you knew this about your phone, at least on this phone, I can swipe all the way left and then go down and it will give me a summary of all the different, like how I've spent my time on my phone. So I'm not cold, I'm not doing all of these terrible things, but if I were to look at how I spend my time on my phone, this is just one example, like, man, how many minutes have I spent wasting my time? So I'm not cold, but I'm also not hot either, especially when you look at this phone. So if you were to look at the analytics on your phone, or what about the analytics of the meditations of your heart? Rehearsing past failure, spending time in mentally indulging fantasies that you know are not honoring to the Lord, coveting, any number of things. All of those things back us down from that hot and put us more into that category of lukewarm. Verse 16 says this, "But since you are like lukewarm water, neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth." The church in Laodicea lived in indifference. That's the first danger, the danger of indifference. There's no indication of persecution. There's no indication of victory. They're kind of stuck in this middle ground. You know, like my life is pretty good. My walk with the Lord is pretty good. I'm certainly not doing all those other things. I mean, I'm not really pressing in here. I'm not sacrificing here. I'm not seeing breakthrough and victory here. But you know, that's okay, because at least I'm not doing it. Can you see what I'm talking about? Jesus wants to come around and sit on the same side of the table with us at Tribe and with you in your heart and say, watch out. Be on guard for, be alert for the danger of indifference. So once we open our eyes, remember that? Those with eyes to see. Oh man, maybe you would find yourself stuck in the midst of indifference right now. Maybe you could see, okay, maybe that's coming down the road. Well, what do I do, Jesus? Again, Jesus doesn't sit on the other side of the table and wag his finger at us like, watch out, you're stuck in indifference. That's it. You're terrible. You're bad. You're awful. Jesus sits on the same side of the table with us and says, warning, we all must guard ourselves from the danger of indifference. Well, how do we do that? Praise the Lord. Jesus gives us the remedy for, or the solution for, indifference, and it's found in verse 18. Skip down a few verses. Let's look at verse 18 together. So I advise you, Jesus is speaking. When he gives advice, we know that it is trustworthy. We talked about this earlier, that it is true. This is advice that we want to build into our lives. So I advise you, buy gold from me. Gold that has been purified by fire. Now, if you've been a part of our tribe fam for any length of time, there should be all kind of connection points. Bzz, bzz, bzz. Your neurons should be firing. Ooh, 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 fire, purification. Buy from me gold that has been purified by fire. Okay, so how do I do that? If something can be bought, then that must mean that it has a price. So what is the price of gold purified by fire in terms of understanding this verse? What is the price of gold purified by fire? Well, it's pretty easy. Surrender in the midst of tribulation. As we go through difficulty, as we go through opposition, as we go through hardship, and we surrender, that's called tribulation, and we surrender, that's where that gold is purchased. Now that might sound great theoretically, but let's get super practical. I hadn't planned on this, but my phone is sitting right here, so let's use this. This is a small but very real and practical application of what we've just been talking about, and then we're going to land the plane, okay? So let's say that I'm cruising through my day, and my day consists many times of meetings and appointments. Sometimes I have meetings here. Sometimes I go to appointments. Sometimes it's appointments through Zoom. But a lot of my day is spent listening to and talking to people. Another portion of my day is sounds really unspiritual. It is spiritual, but it sounds unspiritual. Just developing content, Bible studies, sermon prep, working on things well in advance. And so I just use my brain a lot of my day is spent using my brain. And so the way that my brain works is I need quick little interruptions so that I can refocus on what it is that I'm doing. I don't know. Maybe that's my ADHD brain. I don't know. But I'm working on something. I'm working on something. When I get to a moment of, like, I get stuck or I run out of thoughts or, what helps me is to do a quick reset. And I have gotten into the habit of, just pick up my phone. I'll pick up my phone, I'll go to news, I'll go to social media or something, just a distraction or an escape. And then after I have spent way too long on something that has no nutritional value, I find myself being like, I gotta get refocused on what it is that I'm working on. Now, is social media a sin? No. Is engaging in looking at current events and news a sin? No. But when those things distract me and take away a disproportional amount of time that they should and occupy a wrong place in my heart, that's when it becomes a sin. So for me, I'm just using a very personal example. So I can look to this as a distraction or to anesthetize me so that I'm not thinking about or dwelling on those things that God wants me to deal with and address. Does that make sense? That's when it becomes a sin. So let's go back to this moment of buying gold purified by fire. I'm in a moment, I have this temptation, just pick up your phone, just escape for a moment. I pick up my phone, I get on, the Holy Spirit whispers to me, put your phone down. I don't want to put my phone down. I don't want to engage in this. But that is that moment right there. That's the tribulation. That's the suffering. That's the heat. Because now, who's going to be the boss? Jesus or my own flesh? Who's going to win in that struggle, that conflict? That's tribulation. Who will win? When I say, Holy Spirit, you're the boss of my life. It's just the news. It's just social media. I was only going to check it for 30 seconds, whatever you want to say to justify it. But you say, but nevertheless, not my will be done, but yours. Off, set it away, out of reach. Do you know what that is? When I surrender to his leadership, that is where I buy gold in that moment. Now, adjust the scale of magnitude for your tribulation, whether it's small and insignificant and it happens 12 times a day, or maybe it's something on a much more painful or larger scale. Tribulation is the same regardless of the scale. Buying gold is the same regardless of the tribulation. What's the price of gold purified by fire? It's surrender in the midst of tribulation. And why is buying gold the remedy or the solution to the danger of indifference? This is kind of the fine print, but perhaps the punchline of the whole message. You cannot stay indifferent for very long in the midst of tribulation. You cannot stay in neutral. You cannot stay indifferent for very long in tribulation. Let's use this example, and then we're going to land the plane. Bopping along through my day, I have the temptation to pick up my phone, to escape, to disengage where the Lord has my heart. I pick up my phone, and I'm going to click on something on social media, and the Holy Spirit says, don't do it. That conflict, that wrestling, that's not indifference. I'm having conflict in that moment. That's what ejects me out of indifference, because I have to make a choice. Either I'm hot by surrendering to the Holy Spirit, or I'm cold and just indulge in social media. I can't stay in that place of indifference, of, well, I guess I'll check, and I'll have the voice of the Holy Spirit saying, son, put your phone down. La, 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 la. I'm checking social media, and I'm hearing the voice of the Holy Spirit trying to get my attention. Son, put your phone down. La, 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 la. I hear you. You say I should put my phone down. Good idea. Good advice. La, 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 la. And I'm still, do you see how that's lukewarm? Cold would be, hey, shut up. I'm not paying attention. I don't hear you. And I just get on my phone. Hot would be, you know what? I'm going to put my phone down. I'm going to buy gold. And I'm going to move on. But that lukewarm is, I'm cold enough that I'm still on my phone, but I'm warm enough that I would acknowledge, hey, guys, we should not be distracted by our phones. Social media can be a real distraction and cause us to fall into danger. Do you see how that lukewarm middle ground is awful to be in? And it's the fire of tribulation that causes us to either get ejected into cold. That's it. I'm not listening. I'm going to reject your advice and counsel, and I'm going to go the direction of being cold. Or I'm going to submit to that fire. I'm going to buy gold, and I'm going to surrender to your leadership, Jesus. Can you see? Can you see how fire of tribulation and the gold that's purchased in the fire of tribulation is the solution to indifference? Does that make sense? Oh man, there's so much more I want to say, but let's stop. Let's pause right here and invite the Holy Spirit to do a little bit of evaluation. He wants to come on the same side of the table as us and speak to our hearts. If there's indifference in any area of our heart, we want Jesus, the faithful, true, amen, to come in and whisper to our hearts, hey, son, daughter, hey, my child, there's some indifference in your heart in this area. So can we take just a moment? Remember at the beginning of the message, I said I love that song, Come Holy Spirit by Martin Smith. Let's just invite him to minister to us through this song. Listen for him as he says, set your church on fire again. This song is only 4 minutes and 46 seconds long, but let's have him just come and whisper to our hearts. Holy Spirit, point out the danger of indifference in our heart. Burn like a fire. If you just want to close your Bible, close your eyes for a moment. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Fall on us, evaluate us. There it is, burn like a fire. Refine us, God. Burn away any indifference in us. Oh, show us your glory, O God. We ask you, Father. Burn away the indifference in our lives, our attitudes towards you, God. Do not spit us out of your mouth as lukewarm. Oh, Jesus. Come, Holy Spirit. Set your church on fire again, God. God, burn away the indifference in our lives. Send the fire of your Holy Spirit. Let us recognize in the midst of tribulation that we have the opportunity to buy gold, gold that's been refined in fire. Help us to avoid the difference. The danger of indifference, Lord. Oh God, help us here at Tribe and your church. Help us. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Oh, we need you. Please forgive me for my indifference. Come, Holy Spirit. Fall on us. Help us to avoid. Burn in us. Ask him to burn in your heart. Send your fire. Oh God. May my life be red hot for you. Oh. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father, that you don't just hammer us. You point out the danger and you show us how to avoid that danger. Thank you for being good to us. Thank you for not sitting on the opposite side of the table and just hammering us. But you say this in love. May we encounter your love. And then out, and then we just reciprocate with love from our heart. Why don't we respond in this moment of ministry? We'll just transition into receiving tithes and offerings. And as an expression of our love and thankfulness for how he loves us and takes care of us, let's just bring our tithes and offerings before the Lord. And I know that there's lots of different circumstances that have brought you to watching the live stream right now. Maybe it's travel and you can't be here with us in person. Maybe because of due to COVID, so to speak, that you are just watching this live stream with just your family. Maybe geographically it's impossible for you to be here. I know that there are members of our tribe fam across the state of Wyoming, across numerous states, and in various countries around the world. But one of the ways that you participate and engage with tribe, if you call tribe your local church, is we bring our tithes and offerings to the local church. And so you know the various ways of giving. Why don't I just go ahead and pray over the offering? Even though I know that many of you give, or you're generous through your smartphone, why don't I just pray over tithes and offerings? We'll share a few quick announcements and then we'll get out of here, okay? So Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you for being good to us. Thank you that you don't just point out our faults, but you love us so much that you want to share us how to avoid those dangers by an expression of telling you that we love you and that we trust you, that you're worthy of our worship. You have worship. We want to bring our tithes and offerings to you. We just ask that you would that you would be blessed by our financial gift that we bring to you today. God, I ask that you would receive these finances. You would use them to make your name famous right here at Tribe, in Jackson Hole, and to the uttermost bounds of the earth. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, how about a couple of announcements? If you do live in this region and your schedule allows it, we'd love for you to participate in all the different things that we have going on here at Tribe throughout the week. Obviously, on Sundays, we have services at 10 a.m. and 5 p.m. Lissa sent out a text blast recently with a survey, and we're getting those survey results back, looking at being able to accommodate more of our tribe fam. And we sent out some different options for a third service on Sunday or maybe a midweek evening service. And so as those results are coming in, we'll let you know how we take your feedback and input along with what Senior Pastor Jesus is leading us to do. So we'll let you know what's going to come as a result of the survey and how Jesus is leading us here in the next week or so. If you haven't had a chance to fill out that survey, it's just on the text blast. So jump online and fill out that Google survey if you would. But here's some of the other things that are going on at Tribe, not just at 10 a.m. and at 5 p.m. on Tuesdays. We have junior high youth that's happening downstairs. Where upstairs at that same time at 6 p.m., we have prayer and worship where we fill the bowl with the prayer of the saints. So we invite you to come and be a part of that time of prayer and worship. It's just been so powerful. And it's been as well attended as our Sunday services, which is awesome. Then right at 7, we have a bite to eat, and then we go into a Bible study together, and we've been watching The Chosen season two. So we'll have another episode of The Chosen season two that I invite you to participate in. Come, have dinner, watch The Chosen, and then we sit around and just discuss it. What sort of connections are you making? Like, have you ever thought about that aspect of Jesus? And just dive into his word and just talk all about Jesus. Wednesdays at 2 p.m. right here at the TMC, we have intercessory prayer. So we invite you to come and be a part of that with Kim Paulson and her prayer team. And then on Thursdays at 6 p.m., either here or outside somewhere, we have our young adults that gather. And they look at different, they're doing all different kinds of things. They have a meal together. They're getting in the word together. As the weather is getting nicer, they're playing outside games. And so it's so great. I'd love if you're a young adult and you live in this area, come join us for young adults on Thursday at 6 p.m. Did I get everything covered, you guys? Yes, I think so. Why don't I pray for you really quick and then we'll get out of here. Whew. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for highlighting dangers that we can see well ahead of time before we ever get there and fall into it. Thank you for highlighting the danger of indifference. Help us to avoid that, Lord. Thank you for giving us the recipe for avoiding the danger of indifference, and that's buying gold. Help us, Lord. The most wise investment we can ever make is to buy gold that has been purified by fire. So Father, I pray that as my tribe fam, as our tribe fam encounters any kind of tribulation, whether it's small on their smartphone or big things that they may be walking through, Father, help them. Give them the courage to buy gold that's been refined in fire so that they can avoid the danger of indifference. I command a blessing over each and every member of our tribe fam. I ask that you would cause them to prosper in everything that they do, in their health, in their finances, in their emotions, in their relationships with their children, in their family. Give them favor with their jobs and with their teachers and coaches. We pray all of these things in Jesus' name, the strong Son of God. And everybody said, amen. Hey, I love you guys so very much. I want you to have a great week, and remember, you got this.